the non-construction service track. We need to talk about how to properly adapt new secondary career pathways at your program to approved and appropriate AmeriCorps service. As always, we would love to see every YouthBuild student co-enrolled in AmeriCorps, but sometimes these non-traditional tracks can take some work to get right for a service term. As more and more programs transition to the Construction Plus model, we are working to adjust and be flexible in offering alternative service avenues that align with them. But we are compelled to make sure that member activity falls within the scope of our grant. So there's going to be some places where this just doesn't fit.
So I'm just going to talk through digital divides as IT pathways. So a lot of folks are investigating this. I think it's an upcoming field where there are a lot of jobs available. There's always work within IT and different networks. So we just want to take a minute to highlight this and show you different ways that it can be done. Let's talk about one of the most important things about any service track is really thinking through what is the unmet community need, right? What is the community problem that your service is trying to solve? So this is really important, especially for non-construction service tracks, because a lot of times what we see is the program will take something that is really designed as a job training track, and then they'll take whatever activity they're doing to get some practical experience, and they'll start calling it service. That's not ideal, because really we want you to be thinking about it as service from the get-go, and really when we talk about service, it's thinking about it from the community's perspective, not just what the member is going to get out of the experience, but what the community is going to receive, right? So if you're going to be building computers, do you have a strong partner who is going to distribute those computers to the community? Is it going to have an impact? So who are the beneficiaries of this service? So, you know, who is really benefiting from it? And does that translate to the member? And I think this part is very important. Does the member feel that they're making an impact on the community? So that's the question that I think you should be asking yourselves throughout the experience is, you know, does the member really understand the impact they're having? And if not, how can we demonstrate it to the member or have them feel it more viscerally? And then the other thing to think about is just, is the service displacement? So this is something we run into anytime we get into, you know, some non-construction service tracks or sometimes full-time members. You know, is the activity displacing something that a staff member should be doing or that other volunteers should be doing? So please be aware of that. And if you have concerns about it, you know, reach out to your portfolio manager so we can talk it through. The other thing to think about with these tracks, again, because a lot of them begin from the place of being a job training track, is really building in enough time within the calendar to be successful. So if you haven't already, we have a program calendar tool that you can download and use. But really just kind of thinking through, what is the schedule for these members? Is there enough service time? You know, is there, you know, not just enough time to get them certified, but enough time where they're contributing to the community and have a really realistic shot at earning that education award. So that's one of the challenges we've seen with these tracks, is that they'll maybe be successful in terms of the job training, but the members aren't earning education awards. And we want to make sure that they're set up for success and they're earning education awards. To help you all with that, we're going to give you some examples from the field. And the first one I want to highlight is in my portfolio, American Youth Works in Austin, Texas. So I've been working with them a while, and I think their story is really interesting because they had the kind of the worst-case scenario where the OIG actually visited them and looked at the program and had questions. And so they really had to take some time to really examine their process and really, you know, construct it in the best way possible. So I'm going to go ahead and unmute Matt here. So Matt is the teacher for the Media Corps at American Youth Works in Austin. So can you go ahead and introduce yourself and share a little bit more about your program?
I'm Matt Stowicki. I am the Media Corps trainer at the program. I've been working with them for about 10 years in this position. We work with a lot of partner programs, working with computers, donating computers out, fixing computers in the classroom, and also working with the City of Austin in a bigger partnership that helps us meet those service hour requirements that are a big challenge. At the same time, we are also working towards obtaining certifications. So we've been working in a pilot program for the A+, and we also do the CompTIA IT Fundamentals.
Great. So would you mind just sharing just, you know, how you make sure the members get a feeling for the impact they're having in the community?
I think we start that off pretty hard from the beginning. During mental toughness, we usually do planning activities where they start planning their own service projects. But in the classroom, once mental toughness is over, day one in the classroom, we start working on computers for people in the community. So, you know, best activity is taking apart a computer and putting it back together and finding out what's wrong with it. That's going to be their starting point. So they understand, and in the classroom we talk about how someone is going to get this. So we don't want to leave bad parts in there, not have good equipment in there. We want to check it. And making sure it's all part of it. I also incorporate them in the donation process. So they have to call the person, talk to the person, and they introduce themselves. They do a tutorial. Make sure that that person may have never have had questions about computers to someone, that they can get that answered with someone who may understand a little bit more. So the students are kind of all from the beginning of it to the end. And this is our second year, but we have started working with the City of Austin in their digital inclusion department, helping build out computer labs in public spaces across the city. We distributed 10 computers a couple weeks ago to our local homeless shelter. So they actually had to go into the homeless shelter, set them all up, see all the people that they're going to be that are going to be using these. They got to meet some of the trainers that were there checking out the computers that were getting set up. So they get a lot of hands-on out in the community and working with people that they may never see.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear that that partnership is going well. So you said you've been doing this for 10 years, so you got a lot of experience under your belt. So what advice would you have for somebody who's thinking about starting up a digital divide IT track?
Yeah, it's a little daunting. You know, we came in and there was, you know, we were doing a little bit of internships, but we really pushed it back to refurbishing computers. Now in the day, I kind of feel like people are more less interested in a desktop computer than they are for phones and tablets. And I think the biggest thing I've had to do is really reach out to local community requesting equipment for us to refurbish and put together. And now I get a stream of people talking. I just told everyone, hey, if you have computer parts, bring them in. You have computers, bring them in. I told everyone in my agency, and lo and behold, I get more than I need every year now because people don't know what to do with it. It's out there. You just have to ask. Second thing, there's a couple of good programs out there for connecting the refurbishing equipment. Microsoft has programs designed for this. The Microsoft Authorized Refurbisher program has really helped because it gets cheap licenses for computers. The last thing I really have done is reached out to a lot of community partners that may need computers or people that would work with have a deficit in not having computers around or available. So we have a Foundation Communities, which is a big housing development here. They work with only low-income families, so they're perfect for getting donations received from us. And I work with local women's shelters who actually, you know, people leave their homes very quickly but still want access for their kids. So there's always people that come in from our local women's shelters to come get computers. So I've went out there and reached out to find some of these other partners that already have the clientele that need computers. A lot of computers are phones now, so we do a lot of phone repair. There's an endless supply of people with broken screens and work that needs to be done. But it's just as valuable and challenging as working on a desktop computer.
Well, yeah, thank you for taking the time out and sharing. I think those are some great ideas, especially, you know, talking about cultivating those partnerships and being really intentional about it. But we're going to go ahead and move on to our next piece.
Portland Youth Builders has been doing this for a long time. And one of the great areas of focus they have for their digital divide track is community education. These members take the training they receive as part of their IT pathway, and they use it to educate older adults at the Hollywood Senior Center on the pitfalls of online life, including how to avoid scams, viruses, and malware. It's a great unmet community need, and it puts them in regular contact with a segment of the population that they wouldn't probably interact with very much. This year, PYB members also designed and delivered smartphones for seniors training at the Immigrant and Refugee Community Organization. They worked through translators to relay this information to three different language groups. Those are some of the examples I've seen. In fact, I actually took that picture the last time I visited. It was really great to see the young people teaching the older folks and pairing up with them too, which I thought was really great. Another great idea that I didn't really flesh out the slide very well, sorry about that, but this year, Portland Youth Builders has begun a new partnership with the Oregon Museum of Science and Industry, a nonprofit center that serves over 1 million visitors a year, engaging them in learning experiences that foster an appreciation of science and technology. Our members volunteer on the museum floor, assisting in the hands-on science experiments happening with youth participants. And for their service, OMSI is a really great partner because they provide the members with family memberships as well as preferential hiring, which I think is really great too. When we think about these partners, especially appropriate nonprofit partners, as future employers of our young people.
So the IT industry is among the economy's largest and fastest growing sources of employment, with an anticipated growth rate of more than 20% over the next 10 years. And the median annual wage for an IT job in May of 2017 was $84,580, compared to the median annual wage for all occupations of $37,690. So though the demand is high, a skill gap remains a major obstacle for employers aiming to fill these occupations. This provides an ample opportunity for YouthBuild sites to expand their career pathway offerings to include the IT sector and empower our students to embark on a dynamic and well-paying career. And while we know that nearly all jobs within the IT industry require post-secondary education, the type of degree or formal training varies. Many well-paying jobs in this industry are, in fact, available to those who successfully obtain an industry-recognized certification. And we know that many IT training providers do exist, yet more than often, they are financially inaccessible and frequently ill-equipped to prepare our YouthBuild student population with the skills for success inside the classroom and on the job. So what we at YouthBuild USA decided to do was to partner with an industry expert to develop an in-house IT training that delivers the industry-recognized certification specifically designed with the YouthBuild student in mind.
So I'm going to provide a very succinct overview of the curricula for the A-plus and the prep course have been designed to provide foundational IT knowledge, skills, and leadership abilities while also facilitating the enhancement of students' work readiness skills. And in addition to technical IT knowledge, both curricula encompass a series of project-based modules which are focused on work readiness skill development opportunities such as problem solving and teamwork, reflection and metacognition, writing and presentation skills. The design of the A-plus curriculum in particular also seeks to engage students in IT and give them the opportunity to demonstrate their acquired competency through on-the-job training experiences as part of an internship. Building on these foundational skills, students will apply learning to one of two certifications. The A-plus curriculum prepares students to sit in for the CompTIA A-plus exam, which is one of the most recognized industry certifications for establishing an IT career. The prep course, on the other hand, prepares students for the Microsoft Office Specialist certification, which validates a job candidate's Microsoft Office skills and abilities.
So let's take a closer look. So it is a 24-week curriculum with 6 additional weeks allotted for the on-the-job training or internship component. The curriculum covers 8 core technical competencies and 5 primary soft skill priority areas that prepare the students to sit for that CompTIA A plus exam and for a career in the IT field. Now for the prep course, this actually came about because we saw that many YouthBuild students come with almost zero knowledge of a computer. So the prep course is designed to be approachable and engaging for all YouthBuild students, regardless of previous IT or computer knowledge. And it can also serve as an on-ramp to the more advanced A-plus training curriculum afterwards. The topics and skills include the introduction to software, hardware, data, and the Microsoft Office programs of Word, Excel, and PowerPoint. And we've embedded career exploration in the IT industry within each of these three modules. To get some examples of service opportunities, we wanted to share what some of the A-plus pilot initiative sites are doing. Matt already did half of this slide for us, so thank you for sharing what you've done in Austin and with the refurbishing, repurposing new computers. And then we also wanted to highlight Dreams. We know students have assisted instructors at the SUNY Attain Lab during community courses to a senior elderly population. So the IT students have been able to kind of help with tutoring them there. And a full-time AmeriCorps State National position was created, which included assistance with the delivery of this IT Pathways initiative.
For those that are interested in exploring this, I would highly encourage that you all, one, don't hesitate to reach out to me and Jessica, but also what we can do is point you all in the direction of some of your colleagues who have had a lot of success in implementing the curricula, both in achieving successes, but also helping to understand some of the potential challenges in launching this particular career path.
If you need any information, please reach out to JD or I, and our emails are on the slide.
Our genuine hope is that you've learned a lot about IT as a career pathway here, but also how you can successfully implement that as a service track. And we're going to wrap up by highlighting a few of the key steps that you would need to take in order to make this successful AmeriCorps service track. And it really begins by identifying that unmet community need. Without that need, it really should just continue as a career pathway track and not an AmeriCorps part of your program. After you've figured out that unmet community need, it really goes to finding that community partner. Who's going to help you with providing those certifications and trainings that you want your young people to have, but also those opportunities for service hours. And then after that, it goes to working on your program calendar. If you're looking to start a new service track, you also want to be doing one of these program calendars to make sure that there's enough service hours for your young people to be successful in completing an AmeriCorps term. And if you find that there isn't, that's okay. This digital divide work could become a secondary service project, and your young people would continue in their construction work. But if there are enough hours, that final step would be to develop a position description. So just wanted to give that overview of all the steps that go into creating a service track. And as always, your portfolio manager is ready to talk with you about this and have this conversation.
My last thought on all of this non-construction service track stuff is a lot of programs have stuff like this for their secondary service, and that's great. But what we're talking about here is creating a whole new track because you'll have members that are just doing IT or just doing community health and wellness. They're not doing construction. There are some programs that offer some, you know, healthcare stuff after a member has finished their, like, high school diploma classroom time. And that's fine. That's secondary service. That's secondary certification. The more we can offer them, that's fantastic. But if your members are still primarily construction-based, you know, this just becomes secondary service. Still love to talk to you about these secondary projects. And, you know, if they're going to be major projects, they should go on the position descriptions for the young people. But when we talk about this, a track is somebody who's doing something completely different than what a traditional construction YouthBuild member is doing. Thank you again for joining us. We really appreciate the opportunity to do something a little different. Have a great rest of your day.